am the Lord. Say, Lord.
Lord.
Turn.
Turn
the captivity of Job. When? When? When he prayed for his no good friends. He had three terrible friends. He said, the friends like your miserable comforters. And so everybody ought to have three friends. I don't know how many friends you have. The Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Double for your trouble. Whatever God's going to put you through, he's going to double up at the end. I want you to know that. This is the principle I want to establish. And my subject is going to be followed by my theme. My theme is a question. This is the question I'm going to ask you. Can God, when I ask you, can God, you need to shout back and say to me, God can. So let me try it. Can God?
Can
God?
God can.
Okay, we got it. So every time I ask the question, can God, you need to bounce back with?
God can.
Okay, that's my theme. Can God? Yes, God can. Can do what? Well, I'm with a particular idea. Somebody said it. My subject is, can God turn it around? Can God turn it around? Are you in prison? Have you been captured? Is your body aching with pain? Have you come out of a sore captivity? What's your condition? No friends to encourage you. You have a situation that there seems to be no hope. No hope. You are so discouraged. You wonder when it's going to end. When is God going to fix my troubles? How am I going to come out of this mess? How will my house be restored? How will my children be restored? How will my finances be restored? Oh God, when is going to end? I see no end in sight. Everywhere is a foolish fight. When? When is it going to happen? When you pray, God will make a way. Understand, this is so much. What I want to explain to you is that whatever the devil has done to you, you can do it back to him.
Yes.
We have a saying back home, do back. You know what do back? Whatever you do me, I do back to you. And I want to prove to you that whatever the enemy has done to you, you have the power to do it back to him. Do not sit there and take his insults. Do not sit there and let the enemy harass you, push you, embarrass you, and break up your family. Fight back. Come back with a fight. Don't sit down there and take what the enemy is dishing out to you. Be a man of God. Be a woman of God. Rise up and roar against the enemy. Can I hear somebody with a shout say yes? Can God change things? God can turn it around. Yes, he can. I want to establish the fact in this verse that the Lord turned it. Only the God can turn it around. No Obia, no Simidimi, no lighting candles, no reading Psalms 109, no taking scissors and putting by your head, no sprinkling water around your house, no holy oil on the floor, no flowers, no incense, nothing. Only the Lord God can turn it around. God must get the glory because he alone has the power. And the Lord turned it around. So if anything's going to turn around in your life, it's going to be because of the power of the Lord. He will turn your captivity. He will turn you loose from prison when you have prayed for your friends. When you have prayed for your situation, then God's going to turn it around. That's my idea. Let me illustrate quickly what I mean to reverse the situation. I will use Samson and show you three things that God will reverse when you pray. What do I mean by reverse? Here is the situation. Samaria is in famine. The enemy has surrounded the city. The people of God is trapped inside the city, and they're surrounded by the enemy. They're starving, they're eating their children, they are fighting, They're quarreling, arguing with the king, and they're blaming Elijah for all the atrocities that the enemy has, because he's besieged the city, surrounded them. They are trapped in the middle. See the picture. People of God trapped in the middle, the enemy around them. That's Samaria. That can change. You can change it and turn it into a Jericho situation where the enemy is in center and the people of God is around praising and worshiping. You can change your Samaria where the enemy surrounds you to the place of Jericho where you put the enemy in the center and you and your family walk around the enemy until his house comes tumbling down. That's what I mean by changing the scenarios. That's what I mean by you don't have to be captured. God can turn it around. Let me go to Samson and show you three things in the book of Judges, chapter 16, verse 21. These are three words I want to use here. Bind, blind, and grind. These three things the enemy will do to you. He could blind you. He could bind you, and he can make you grind. And I want to show you by the power of God, when you pray, you can reverse the situation in so much that you could bind the devil. You could blind the devil, and you can make the devil grind your corn. You can make him your servant. Instead, for all these years, you have served the devil, and you didn't know it. You can have the thing turned around where the enemy will serve you. I will show you how. Can I hear an amen? Verse 21. You know the story. Samson played around. He played around. He played the fool. This man was anointed. He had a contract with God. He was under covenant anointing. As long as you keep that hair on your head, you will never be under the power of the enemy. But if you lose it, if you lose my covenant agreement, if you lose my touch, if you lose the symbol I have upon you, then you are without my aid. And he got up that. She just made him sleep on his knees, on her knees. And he called. A man shaved off his seven locks. And he got up and said, I'm going to shake myself as at other times. That was one shake that had no power in it. You know, sometimes you shake and you have power. And then sometimes you shake and nothing happens. This is one of those times. And she said, Samson, awake! The Philistines are upon you. He woke out of his sleep and said, I will go out as other times and shake myself. And he wist not that the Lord was departed from him. Didn't realize it. He thought that he could get away with it all the time. Come to the place where he didn't realize God had moved. Is God still with you? What are you doing to drive God from your life? What have you done to drive God from your home? I tell you, if you keep watching those X-rated movies and those R-rated movies with your family, you will drive the presence of God out of your house. I tell you, if you keep watching those filthy stuff, you and filth and God can't stay in the same house. You gotta keep it clean. Can I hear clean? Amen. And he played the fool and didn't know that God had gone from him. And watch what happens now. And the Philistines took him and put out his eyes. That is mild language. The other translation says, they gouged his eyes out. One of the commentators said that the method of taking eyes out was to hot a sharp pointed piece of iron. And could you imagine the strong mighty man in brass chains with a headband tied against his head and strapped around a post so that his head cannot move as he watched that hot iron coming to his eyes. And without mercy, that man rams that spike into his eye and dig it out. The pain, the agony. And he's screaming and nobody's caring. And another toss, another round to take the same spike as they pull the eyeball out and goes for the other eye. This is reality. This is how they gouge his eyes out with a hot piece of metal and stuck it in there. And disconnected from its tissues and nerves and the muscles that hold it around, rip it out of his eyes. They blinded him in pain because he played with sin. And God was no longer with him. The enemy blinded him. You've got to be filled with so much vengeance against the enemy. There must be so much built up inside of you that when you charge at the enemy, you charge with a righteous hatred for everything that's evil and everything that's nasty and unclean around you. Your soul must get vexed with righteousness over what's taking place around you. While they are proving homosexual marriages and abortion, you can't say if that's okay with them, it's okay with me. Your soul have to get vexed. Your spirit have to rebel. You have to cry against the sins of this world on your knees to God and say, God, have mercy. You must gather a vengeance inside of you and unleash it against the devil. Because he has blinded you. He's taken out your eyes. You can't see as you used to see it before. Now you're groping in the dark. Now you're fiddling and trying to find your way around. You have no eyes. Can God turn it around? Can God turn it around? 2 Kings chapter 6. Elijah, long story short, is surrounded by the 80,000 Syrian army. His servant began to tremble. Oh Lord, Master, what shall we do? What shall we do? Look at the army. Look at the army. Elijah prayed. That's the secret. Elijah prayed and said, oh Lord, open the eyes of my servant that he might see what I am seeing. And the Lord opened the eyes. This man's eyes was open, but still he couldn't see what the servant of the Lord was saying. And the Lord opened his eyes and he said, look on the hills. And when he looked on the hills, swarming with a multitude, a great host of horses and chariots and fire. And he screamed, ah, Master, the chariots of fire and the horses thereof. God can open eyes. But God can also blind open eyes. The second miracle in that is Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I want you to blind this whole army. Not one man, not a dozen. Thousands of them. Blind them, blind them, blind the enemy, blind them. He prayed. Suddenly, the entire army went into darkness. The entire army was blinded. And now one man, Elijah said, follow me. Two men leading thousands of the enemy into the city. When you pray, you can lead the show. When you pray, you can blind the enemy. They don't have to find you. If you have the bank looking for you, do like me. Pray. Lord, don't let them find me until I'm ready to deal with them. 6 months later, they found me. But they were blinded for a while. And I managed to fix up things in the meantime that they got blinded. You can blind the enemy from your child. That enemy that have zeroed on your family to destroy you. Say in Jesus' name, devils, I blind you. You can't find my child. You can't find my job. You can't find my money. He is hunting. He is searching. He's a thief and a robber. He comes to steal. You could stop him. You don't have to take it. You ask God, you pray, Lord, blind him. Yes. Remember, Brother Andrews, God's smuggler, going through the Iron Curtain. he would have a suitcase full of Bibles. He knows it's contraband. He will be arrested at the border. He said, Lord, you made blind eyes to see. Now I ask you to make seeing eyes blind. And he would walk with his, open his brief, his suitcase full of Bibles. They would look into it and see nothing and tell him, go through. When God wants something done, if he has to blind the enemy to get you through, he can do it. Can God blind the enemy? So you can go through. Amen? Yes, he can. The second word is bind. Where's Brother Dale? I joked with him this morning that the word D-E-O in Greek means to bind. So anytime you see Brother Dale, say, Brother, bind some devils for me. He said he don't like that name so much. He liked how the Jamaicans said, Deo, Deo. I said, well, whatever way you like it, brother, that's what it means. It means to bind. And so they bound him. Have you ever felt bound? And your liberty taken away? Have you felt like that there is no victory, no movement, no freedom? Why? Have you found that there is something upsetting your house that every time you try to put things in place, something or somebody goes and upsets it behind your back? And that you find yourself trailing broken pieces and damages. All you are doing is repairing things in your home and in your family and your relationships. You're just following a force and a power that you have allowed to run amok in your family. And you need to do something about it. Hear what Jesus said. Matthew 12:28. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house? Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We bind you in Jesus' name, strong man, because a stronger than you is here. Hallelujah. A strong man, don't bind a strong man. Jesus said, a stronger than he must come. I hear John said, greater is he who is in you. Greater, stronger, mightier than all them devils out there. Bind him in Jesus' name. Don't let him spoil your family. I saw in Judges chapter 3, I preached to you how the spoilers would come and spoil everything you have. Here is a chance for you to return the favor. Everything that the enemy has spoiled for you, you can now return the favor and spoil the plans of the enemy. You can spoil his goods. You can take back what the enemy took from you. You have the power. You have the choice. You can sit down and let him push you in the corner and let him further damage you every day. Or you can rise up, bind the devil, and spoil his goods. Are you going to do it? Can God turn it around? Yes, he can. Yes, he can. The third word is grind. They made him to grind in the prison. The most humiliating task for a man is to grind corn. It's a woman's job. It's the job of a slave woman or a prostitute. They humiliated this mighty warrior so terribly that they made him grind in the prison corn. A humbling task. And he grind in the prison house. Have you been grinding the devil's corn? Have you been doing the work of the enemy? You've got to ask yourself the question. Have I been assisting Satan in the damaging work of the church? Have I been partnering with the devil to gossip, backbite, ill speak, pull down, hurt somebody's character? Am I involved in character assassination? I am helping the devil to hurt somebody who belongs to the kingdom of God. Am I in league with Satan? Am I grinding his corn? And because my eyes have been taken out and I've been bound, I don't know what I'm doing. You can reverse it. You can change the situation. Let me give you three quick illustrations how you can make the devil serve you. How God can turn it around and make the enemy become your servant instead of your master. God said to Elijah, go by the brook. For there I have commanded the ravens to feed you. Of all the birds. The raven. You know where we get the word ravenous from? From the raven, the bird, because he's greedy. The ravens are not known to share. They will eat and vomit, eat and vomit, eat and vomit. They will never stop eating. That's why they're ravenous. You can't get anything from a raven. Mean and stingy. Selfish. It's all for me. Eat, fill up himself, get rid of it, and go back and eat again. God said, I have commanded the unclean raven to bring food for you. That's a contradiction of nature, but the power of God can defy the human and the animal qualities around us to bring bread and meat for his children. Can God turn it around? Can God use the enemy and the unclean boss to bless you and to give you a raise? Can God use the same banker who threw you out of his office and then give you a phone call and say, hey, come back, I got good news for you? Can God? God can. Hallelujah. Make the ravens, man. Here is a famine for 3.5 years, no rain. Where are these ravens getting bread and meat? This is not raw meat. This is cooked meat. A raven could thief. And where you think they got it from? Jezebel's stable. She had enough food to feed 850 prophets. She had food. The enemy had food while the prophets of the Lord were starving. But God commanded. He said, I will change it around. I will make the enemy feed you. Another thing I notice in Joshua chapter 9. The Gibeonites played a trick on Joshua. They were just 8 miles away from where Joshua was standing. And they came dressed up. Old clothes, tattered and torn, worn shoes, moldy bread, stale wine, torn wineskins. Oh, look at this. We've come from a far country. And we want to make a league with you. Promise you will never hurt us, destroy us. You look at the outward circumstances. This is what the Bible says. And they took not counsel at the mouth of the Lord. They did not pray about this decision. And they made a league with them. 3 days later, they would discover that they were neighbors. And when they went to kill them, they couldn't because they had sworn, gave them their word that they will save them. And this is what happened. In Joshua chapter 9, I want to show you how God could take things and turn it around. And Joshua made them that day hewers of wood and drawers of water for the congregation and for the altar of the Lord, even unto this day, that they should serve God's people. God turned it around and made them serve. Made them cut wood and bring it. Made them fetch water and bring it for the entire congregation. I declare unto you that God has power to change the circumstance. And for this entire congregation, he can make the enemy serve you. He can God? Listen to this old lovely story of an 80-year-old saint. Every morning she would come out on the porch and she would praise the Lord. She lives alone and she would irritate her two atheist neighbor. And they got tired of hearing, my God takes care of all my need, hallelujah. She would walk up and down the porch and sing and praise God. And they say they'll pull a trick on her one of these days. So they went, bought a big basket of food, bread and all the goodies, put it by her door. Watch to see what she was going to do. She came out, Hallelujah. The Lord has provided. He remembered his servant.
It came up.
The Lord didn't. We took our money. Here's the receipt. And we bought that basket for you.
She said, well, that even makes it more glorious.
For the Lord supplied my needs, and he made the devil pay for it. Can God do it again? Can God make the devil pay for it? I believe so. I believe when you put faith in God and when you pray unto the Lord God, he will change the situation.
Look at Samson. We're closing off here now. They decide to make sport with him. In verse 25, verse 26, there was a little lad that led him by the hand. He said, let me feel the pillars where the house stand that I may lean on them. Now the house was full of men and women, more than 3,000 of them on the rooftop. And they made sport with Samson. They mocked him. Listen, don't mock. Don't mock even a man who had been used of God. You never know what God can do, how God can change a man's day. What Samson was yesterday, he's not today. God can change things. God can change people. God can change history. God can go back, send us the sundial back and change things. Don't underestimate the power of God. He is the same. He cannot change. Oh, time doesn't change him. He can reverse anything. And so Samson, regretting his awful past, cries out to the Lord one more time. And I can feel the pain of the servant of God, the embarrassment and the humiliation. And Samson called unto the Lord, Jehovah! He's in the house of Dagon, the fish god, the half man, half fish god. And he called on the word is Jehovah. And said, oh, Jehovah, Adonai, remember me. I pray thee and strengthen me one last time that I may avenge myself on these wicked, evil. Nowhere in the Bible I find a better picture of Calvary and its damaging effects on the kingdom of Satan. And as Samson, that strong man, stretched his hands, he prayed and he pushed. You know, push, pray until something happens. And he found himself between the two pillars. See Jesus Christ on the cross. His two hands, you thought they were nailed? No, they were fastened to the two pillars that held up the kingdom of Satan. And Jesus prayed his last prayer. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And then he said, it is finished. And he pushed the pillars that held up the house of Satan. It came crumbling down. And in the death of Christ, he destroyed the lords of the Philistine. He destroyed the lords of Sheol and Hades. He destroyed him that had the power of death. When he died, pray and push. Can God do it again? Yes, he can. When Job prayed, God turned his captivity around. When Samson prayed, God flipped things around. These are the three flips. If the enemy binds you, God can flip it around where you can now come and bind the enemy. If the enemy blinded you and you couldn't see things, God can open your eyes and he can blind the enemy. Can't God do it?
If he made you grind, and you've been slaving and slaving and slaving, and you had a bag full of holes, and you saved up nothing, God can change it around. God can make the enemy serve his purpose. That ugly, stinking boss that don't like you, that person who on that job makes life miserable for you, that neighbor who will not let you rest in peace, that troublesome spouse who doesn't know God and hates you and your salvation, God can change it. God can turn it around. He turned it around for Job. He turned it around for Samson. He turned it around for Joshua. And for Jesus, he turned it around. He can turn it around for... Can God? Can he deliver you? Can he make your needs? Can he heal your body? Can he supply all your needs? Can God? Woo-hoo! I know what I am saying is the truth. He did it for Job. He can do it for you. There's a little tweak here. God said, you know, you three boys, go let Job pray for you. Why? Because you didn't speak well about me to Job. Read the 42nd chapter. You didn't talk the truth, but my servant did. Look at the irony of it. The man who is in boils, the man who lost everything, the man who's afflicted by the devil, the man who was discouraged, the man whose wife said, curse God and die, the man who lost everything, to him God gave the honor of the power to pray successfully. Go to him and let Job pray for you. And when he prays for you, I will not kill you. Read it. God was about to smite the three of them. The prayer of Job saved them. You never know whose life you will save when you pray for them. Pray for those who mock you. Pray for them who didn't give a good testimony about you. Pray for them who really don't have anything good to say about you. All lies, of course, but pray for them nevertheless. And when you pray for them, God will set you free. That's how it works. Pray! Pray until God makes a way! Hallelujah, somebody. Can God do it again? Can God do it today? Can God do it now? You believe so? Stand to your feet. Let's take it. Let's take it. I feel this is highly prophetic of what's going to happen this week. I don't think this is an accidental word. I feel this is an intentional word. I feel God wants you to know that the end of your captivity has come. That you have suffered long enough. And that your suffering was not meant for a lifetime, but only for a season. And today is the day, the first day of the restoration of God's power in your home, in your finances, in your family, in your job. You better believe God, for all things are possible to him who would. Oh my God. 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 Do it today, Lord. Do it today, Lord. Stop the captivity. Blind the devil. Bind the devil. Make him grind. Oh, pull down the house of the devil today, Lord. Destroy the enemy. The two words that are coming to my vocabulary that God said to use
and they use forcefully. One is chase. One will chase 1,000. You alone could put 1,000 demons to flight. Did you know that? So why are you asking for help? Assert yourself in God. Understand your power. You are not a weakling. Don't live like you've been defeated. When Jesus saved you, he started you on the more than conqueror level. Walk from there. You're more than conquerors. One will chase 1,000. You got to begin to chase. I give a humorous illustration Wednesday night. Let me just share it back with, for those of you who didn't. Back home, we have a madhouse. And this madman got a cutlass. And he ran the doctor down. And the doctor saw this madman coming. The doctor ran. And he ran. And he ran until he had no more strength and he fell down. And he thought this was it. The madman said, hand him the cutlass. He said, get up. It's your turn to chase me down now. I heard the devil say that. He's tired of chasing. It's your turn to chase him now. Take up your weapon and chase the enemy. You got to chase. You can't let somebody do it for you. You will chase 1,000. You. Get on the chase. Run them down in Jesus' name. And wherever you see them, hack them to pieces. Destroy! Destroy! Destroy the destroyer. You can. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Wherever you see his works in your home, in your family, in your church, destroy it. You have the power to destroy it. Go ahead and destroy it. You become the destroyer. Move Arnold Schwarzenegger aside. And you become the Terminator. Say, Satan, this is where you stop. I will not tolerate your attacks anymore. Fight back. Fight back. Take back your family. Take back your finances. Take it from his hands. Don't let him push you around anymore. Can God do it? Can God change things around for you? He will do it today. Raise your hand and let's believe God for this miracle. Your word have gone forth. Your word will bring life and victory. Let your people believe your word and prosper. Let your people hold on to your word. This is the day of turning, the day of release, the day when you sign the papers and say, Job, you come out of prison. Child of God, you won't be suffering this week. What you suffered last week. Child of God, you won't be crying this week. Because you cried enough last week. Saint, you've been so oppressed and so tormented. You couldn't sleep. Day after day, night after night, the oppressor, the tormentor came. And made a hell in your bed. You couldn't sleep. You can't eat. But this week will be another week. From today, for those of you who believe and accept your release from captivity, God will turn it around for you. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is God and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently pray and seek him. Your miracle is on your way if you pray. Pray now, saint of God. Pray. Call Jehovah. Call. Go ahead. Just say the name. Call Jehovah. Go ahead. Call. Just say the name.